tonight, let's grab our Bibles and turn, if you would, to a couple of places, to be honest with you. It's going to be a lot of Bible tonight. And I hope you would say you get a lot of Bible every Wednesday night. But this is going to be kind of neat because I'll spare you a lot of hassle in the sense that the portion of Matthew 13, go ahead and turn there, Matthew 13, it is a combo deal tonight. We get a combo deal, a supersized version of the same truth. In fact, Jesus brings this parable before the hearers wrapped up together. Yes, technically, Bible students, if you're taking a test, these are two separate parables. But they're the only two separate parables that land the airplane at the same field. They come back to the same purpose. They may have a little bit of variation, but the players are the same, the point is the same, and the landing is the same. That's why tonight you see that we've entitled it this way, the parable of the hidden treasures, plural, okay? There is the pearl of great price. You heard about that parable? That's going to be incorporated into this. And then you've heard of the parable of the hidden treasure. They both speak of the same thing, which causes us to take notice. Before we get going into this, I'm going to ask you to have your pens ready and have your Bibles very, very handy so you can get into this. Before we get to Matthew 13, 44 to 46, I'm going to remind you of Matthew 13, 1. On the same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the sea of Galilee. And great multitudes gathered together to him so that he got into a boat and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore. Verse 3, then he spoke many things to them in parables. Are you ready to use your Bible? Holding your finger in Matthew 13, run to the left. It's about in the middle of your Bible. If you shut your Bible and open it up, you're going to land in either the book of Psalms or Isaiah. Go to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6. And while you're turning there, I want to remind you, Jesus spoke to the people in parables. The crowds in parables. Isaiah 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah says, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train, or his glory, of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim. That they are incredibly bizarre types of angelic creatures. Why? Each one of the seraphim have six wings. With two, he covered his face. In the presence of God, their face is always covered. And with two, he covered his feet. And with the remaining two, he flew. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Wow. And the post, Isaiah says, of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out. And the house was filled with smoke. So I said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar, and he touched my mouth with it. And he said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away, and your sin purged. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, send me. And he said, go and tell this people. Keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and their ears heavy. And shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and return and be healed. What is God saying? Wow. I have preached to these people. I have sent my prophets. I have cried out to them. I have done miracles. I know them. They know who I am, but they don't obey me. And God says, that's it. The book of Isaiah continues to speak on, and God says, I will speak to the people in parables. The truth will land right alongside their ear, but because they're not willing, watch church, because they're not willing to obey the truth that lands right alongside them, instead of blessing them, their heart won't receive it. And their heart will turn that very word that can liberate someone, it will turn it into a curse for them. Because they're not open. That is a grave warning to any of us who take lightly the word of God. Parables are serious business. A parable, as we've mentioned before, is a multifunction way of delivering truth. And when it approaches a willing heart and mind, it unlocks that willing heart and mind more. It brings more light. Are you willing tonight to know the word of God and to be open to God? Are you willing tonight to say, God, here I am, send me. Woe unto me, I'm the one that's undone. Woe unto me, God, I'm in trouble. And have you had, as it were, the seraphim fly from the altar and, as it were, announce unto you, your iniquity has been taken away and your sin purged? And your response will be, without rights, without defense, here I am. That person, that heart of yours, God says, get out of my way. See that heart? I want to pour more light into that heart. Oh, when I throw out my word, their heart is so hungry for it. And listen, as they sit in darkness, when the word of God lands, they grab it and light begins to shine out of darkness. And they begin to see. A parable acts as a judge. And we need to remember that. So the message for tonight is this: what Jesus thinks about you. What Jesus thinks about you. We're going to finish that statement here in 5 points. And I need all of you to listen carefully, because you can get 100 pastors and 50 of them will interpret this parable one way and 50 will interpret it the other way. And I want you to know tonight, we're going to interpret it the right way. You'll see why in a moment. It's a lot of fun. What Jesus thinks about you. Here we go. It's Matthew 13, verses 44 to 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Verse 45. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. The kingdom of heaven. Jesus is announcing what it's like. Let's be very careful tonight, and note takers, this now is very much my opinion. It's necessary to share it. You might say, well, who cares about your opinion? I understand that, but it works for the study tonight, and I need you to hear this. It's foundational, I believe. When we talk about the kingdom of heaven, let's be very careful to remember this, that the kingdom of heaven, first of all, means this. It is the rule and the reign of the Messiahship of Jesus Christ in a person's life is the number one thing. Remember that. That's where it begins. The kingdom of heaven is the rule and the reign of Christ, of Messiah, in an individual's life. But for the nation of Israel, there is both a personal salvation in the Messiah and a national salvation for the nation. The nation of Israel. Follow along now, and I need you to be ready. We're going to give you some important information here. Jesus said to both Jew and Gentile alike, Matthew 10, verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles. Isn't that a shocker? The first missionary journey, Jesus tells his disciples, don't preach the good news to the Gentiles. And do not enter a city of the Samaritans. But go rather to what? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Some of your Bibles say the kingdom of heaven is near you. That's a good word. The kingdom of God is the opportunity for you to have the lordship of Jesus Christ ruling and reigning over your life. Now, you guys all know that's true. You are not going to go to heaven because the lordship of Jesus Christ is ruling and reigning over your church or whatever, wherever your membership might be or wherever you attend a church service. The church cannot save you, and you're not going to go to heaven riding on the back of your church. That's impossible. The kingdom of God comes near every one of us. The preaching of the gospel is to announce that the kingdom of God is near you. And what's the whole thrust and the whole finish to that? The kingdom of God is near you, so open up your heart and receive him and be saved. That's what we're all about. That's what you want to be about. But the offer of salvation based upon the very words of Jesus Christ himself, which, listen, he's fulfilling the very prophecies of the Old Testament, had to first begin with the nation of Israel. Do you understand that? It had to go to Israel first. And you've read the book of Acts where when they kept refusing the gospel, then they said, okay, listen, then we're going to go to the Gentiles. The Lord's opened the door for us to go to the Gentiles. This does not mean we stop witnessing to Jews. In fact, I've got to tell you, I would much rather witness to a Jewish person than a Gentile person. Because Gentile people witnessing is very boring. And when you witness to a Jewish person, it is so much fun. It's a blast. You still tell the Jewish people about the gospel. There are Jews still getting saved. But there's a veil, as 2 Corinthians 4 talks about, over their eyes at a time like this. God lifts it from time to time and open hearts within the Jewish nation, people. But the gospel is going to the ends of the earth right now, and that's God's plan. God has not cast away the Jews forever. Book of Romans makes it very clear. God's people will be restored. There'll be a remnant saved, and it's awesome. The future of Israel, though there's tremendous tribulation coming, the future is prophetic, biblical, and amazing. Exodus 19, 3 through 5. Mark it down in your margins. Mark it down in your notes. Exodus 19, 3. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, thus you shall say to the house of Jacob. What's another name for Jacob? Israel. And tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you out to myself. Therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Keep that in mind. Now watch this. God is still fulfilling his word with Israel and the Jew. Watch now. Turn to Galatians 3:26. Galatians 3:26. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Now, who's he talking to? He's talking to the church at Galatia, but who's going to read this? These are Gentiles. But listen, the church, when the church first got started, it was almost exclusively Jews who had gotten saved. Did you know that? There were very few Gentiles that had gotten saved. Now the gospel is advancing. It's going out. Verse 27, Galatians 3. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither, what? Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Isn't that amazing? That is awesome. Ephesians 2:11. Ephesians 2:11. Are you guys turning the pages in your Bible or turning the pages on your iPad or whatever you're doing there? Okay. I see you glowing out there. I see your screens. Ephesians 2:11. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, Gentile Jew, made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, he's talking about the Gentiles, having no hope without God in the world. But now Christ Jesus, you who once were far off, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Do you remember when Jesus told Nicodemus, the chief master Jewish teacher, you need to be born again? How does a Jew get to heaven? The same way you get to heaven. Jesus told a Jew in John 3, you must be born again. Jesus told that to a Jew before he ever told it to Gentiles. How does a Jew, how does a Gentile get to heaven? You've got to be born again, okay? God came to save sinners. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
This is what the Bible teaches. So, what Jesus thinks about you, mark it down number one, is, oh, how you are loved. Loved. Don't let anyone misinterpret this parable and rob you of great joy, my friend, ever. Look at your Bible, mark verse 44. You are loved. That's what this parable is communicating. In fact, look, Matthew 13, 44, there in it says, for joy over it, that is the treasure hidden in the field. Look at verse 46, who when he had found one pearl of great price. Don't think for a moment that the hidden treasure is Jesus and the pearl of great price is Jesus. That is not what this parable teaches. There are hymns that are written saying such a thing, and it is biblically inaccurate. Number one thing, mark it down, and you'll see it come to light in a moment. What Jesus thinks about you, Jew or Gentile, right now, is that you are loved. You are loved by God in such a way that it is unfathomable for you to comprehend. It is beyond your scope of understanding how much God loves you. And don't equate for a moment what you're going through in life is basing or somehow indicating God's love for you or God's God not loving you. That has nothing to do with what he has said. He says, I love you. Who has he said this to? Well, how far do you want to carry this? Number one, he says it to the Jewish nation, to the Jewish people. He loves them. He says to the Gentile world, I love you. And if that's not satisfactory enough, the Bible tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. More on that in a moment. God announces in the Bible of his great love for you. What does Jesus think about you? He's the one giving the parable. And this gets very, very exciting. Because he's talking about the kingdom of heaven. And it is like a treasure hidden in a field. We know from our previous studies in what is called expositional constancy, a law of biblical interpretation, you can't mess it up. If you do mess it up, then you create a cult. That's how you create a cult, is that you do not obey the laws of biblical interpretation. Number one, we've already been introduced to what the field is. The field is the world. Jesus already told us that. In the world, there is a treasure that is hidden in the world. Keep this mind going. Keep this thought going. Which a man found and hid. Now, a man found and hid. Who would be the man? The interpretation, consistency, a man went out and sowed seed. Do you remember who that was? None other than the Lord himself. Remember? The seed was the word of God. The man, Jesus, is speaking of himself. Well, then why does it say that he hid? He got it, he found, and he hid. Watch this. The word doesn't mean hide, like Jesus found you and he wants to keep you under wraps and not let you come out. It speaks about the sovereignty of God in what he knows. Jesus cannot learn anything. God cannot learn anything. And this verse speaks of that in the earth, think about it, for the last 2,000 years, God, who alone knows this, every generation of people, there are believers that to the mind of God, he already knows who they are. How does that, doesn't that get you excited? I like that. What are we supposed to do? Preach to every creature. Because we don't know. Evangelize everybody. But God knows who's going to accept him. Where, how does that play out in the parable? Oh, Jesus says they're hidden in this world. Think about the people that you're going to see in your ministry lifetime, in your faithfulness to Christ, that are going to accept the Lord. Is it going to be your grandma? Is it going to be your child? Is it going to be your neighbor? Isn't it amazing? Right now, they are as though they were hidden, but not to the mind of God. You don't know. I don't know. That's why we're supposed to preach to everybody. Are you with me? Well, you know, I'm going to wait and see. Oh, let it go. Jesus said, go preach to every creature. You can walk around Chino Hills and preach to the cattle roaming out there and practice on them. Or to be more biblical, I guess you could go down the road and preach to some sheep. Keep it in the family, you know? But God loves us. The communication is love. And I want you to think about this for a moment. Why did Jesus Christ leave heaven to come here? Why would Jesus put up with mankind's dealings with him as mankind has dealt with him? Why? Why would Jesus subject himself to the cross? The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews that Jesus embraced the cross for the joy that was set before him. You ever think about that? Jesus never tried to get off the cross. He never tried to get out of it. You and I would have tried to get out of it. We would have done everything to get out of the cross. Jesus didn't. Jesus, in fact, said, when the time comes, I'm going to lay down my life. The Bible says that he never opened his mouth in defense. Read the fine print. He said, I lay down my life and I will raise it up again. Wow. John 3:16, I mentioned a moment ago, check this out. For God so loved the world, that's the field in the parable, that he gave his only begotten son. This is the price paid, the gift given, salvation, that whoever would be the pearls or whoever would be the treasure. Mark it down, it's going to come together later. Some of you are going, what? Believes on him should not perish but have everlasting life. That is salvation. And let me add this. Isn't it precious that the Bible tells us that when one sinner repents and comes to Christ in salvation, that the angels in heaven rejoice over one convert to Christ? That is absolutely awesome. It's all about the love of God for you. Jesus Christ, the cross, his mission, his brutality received, The ministry revealed is all because he loves humans. And you might say, well, okay, I'll give you that. He loves humans. He loves you. Why do we resist this? I'm prone to this too. I'm confessing for you. It seems more economic to me if Jesus would love more people. Maybe this section over here. There's more. But that's how you and I think. We think like this. How much can I get for that? How many of those do I get for this much? Right? Yeah. We're always looking for a deal, which is great. But in the mind of God, he doesn't have that economy like we do. I can't explain this. How is it that God is 100% delighted over the fact that he would have come and died on the cross for one sinner? If Adam and Eve would have been the only ones that have ever lived after their fall, Jesus still would have come and died. I don't get that. Come on, Costco, load up my pallet, man. If I'm going to lay down 10 bucks, I want 500 of them. God doesn't think like that. Isn't it amazing? That should comfort you because he loves you so much that he goes through every situation with you and he's going to take you through every situation. He's absolutely committed because he's not a human. He came and became a human for us. He is God Almighty. He's eternal. He is spirit. Jesus said that God is spirit and he is truth. And though that sounds too good for us, it is true. He loves you, and he would have died for you. This gets fun. You ready? Jeremiah 31:3, which will explain why we had that elongated introduction. Jeremiah 31:3. Yes, God said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you. Bible students, paying attention, who is he speaking to? Anybody? Class, anyone? Class. He was speaking to Israel. He was speaking to the nation of Israel. But Pastor, I love that verse. I do too. Well, is it for Israel? Yes. Oh, I thought it was for me. Yes. Well, who's it for? You. But what if I'm not Jewish? It's yours. What if I am Jewish? It's yours. Here's the requirement, Nicodemus. Do you believe him? There's neither Jew nor Gentile. All the promises of God in Christ Jesus are yes and amen. Every one of them. That is good news. So as a Gentile, can I say that God has loved me with an everlasting love? Oh, yeah. And he's drawn me to himself? Oh, yeah. Is there a New Testament counterpart to that? Oh, yeah. John 6:37. Jesus said, all that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. Those verses are eternally connected. The promise, first given to Israel, but now has been adopted by the Christian. Because, like, mark this verse down. It just came into my mind. It's not going to be on the screen. It's Romans chapter 2, verses 28 to 29 says, he is not a Jew who is one circumcised outwardly of the flesh with human hands, but he is a Jew who is circumcised inwardly, whose circumcision is of the heart and not of hands, whose praise is not from men, but from God. What does that mean? That the word Jew, is your name Jude? Is your name Jude? Anybody? How about Judy? Any Judys here tonight? No Judys? One Judy on the aisle. Well, for her, the word Jew, Jude, Judy, Judith, is one who praises, a praiser, to praise God. So all the rest of you don't know what I'm talking about, apparently. Isn't that amazing? Who's a real Jew? A real Jew is one who's been circumcised in the heart. That's the issue. How does Jew and Gentile become one? Only one way. Is your heart circumcised? I like that. Number two tonight is this. What Jesus thinks about you is how you are valued. The value of you. Now, you guys need to really eat this message up because this is the most positive message I think I've ever delivered in my life. I mean, he loves you. He just oozes over you. And he values you greatly. He values you beyond your ability to estimate yourself or anyone else. Just think about the people that we might say under our breath or maybe out loud, I don't like them. Well, you know what? Now you're at odds with God. Oh, yeah, but they're so obnoxious. He loves them. You ever seen somebody that you just absolutely, I wouldn't give that guy the time of day. Jesus gave that guy his life. Wow. You're so valued. Back to the parable, verses 44 and 46 again, treasure hidden in the field, treasure. The parable says you are a treasure hidden in the field of the world. And there's a man, the man Christ Jesus, who sees you in the world, and you're a treasure to him. Ah, that's precious. And verse 46 says, a pearl of great price. Valued. Jesus is communicating the great value of the lost sinner. It is awesome to think. By his nature, he will not leave us lost in eternity forever. He came and provided a way. Now, granted, he will not make you go to heaven. You know that. I don't want anything to do with this. Then don't have anything to do with it. Just know this. God's truth and his announcement goes out to your heart just like it does to the person sitting next to you. It's what you do with it that will forever seal your fate in eternity. Will you accept his 100% provided free gift of salvation? No. Well, then listen. You are continuing down a path that you were born into. A path alienated from God and from his promises. But he loves even the worst of sinners who in this world are living and those who have died. The Bible says that God is, he weeps over the death of the wicked. You and I rejoice over the death of the wicked. God weeps over the death of the wicked. We all rejoice when Osama bin Laden got his dues. God wept. Isn't it weird to think? When Saddam Hussein died, God wept. I cheered. Isn't that pathetic? He's amazing. John 17, how valued are you? John 17, 1, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, this is a prayer. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. As you have given him authority, notice the Holy Spirit is speaking through Jesus, third person. As you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And here's the definition of eternal life. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. Wow. How much are you valued? So much that God would send his Son. Think of the depth of this meaning. Now go or look to 1 Corinthians 6, 19. 1 Corinthians 6, 19. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? Whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Remember the parable. A man saw a treasure in a field, and he bought it. A man saw a pearl of great price, and he bought it. Jesus bought, isn't it strange? Jesus creates the universe, including the earth, but by his own life has to buy it or redeem it out of slavery, sin slavery. Why? He does that to get out of it precious things. God sees you as so valued. We're going to have to receive this by faith, people. It's just not normal for us to go, I'm so valued. Oh, am I loved? I understand that. But you know what? We are. It should change your attitudes a bit, huh? It should certainly affect how we treat other people. You're going to go home, you know, to that unbelieving wife or husband that let you go to church tonight. They're glad. Get out of here. Go take your Bible. Go sing your little songs. I'm going to watch the game, drink some beers, kick back. You can tell me all about the sermon when you get home tonight. Well, I know, you know, you're tempted to go home and, oh man, there's that bum. Jesus loves that bum. He loves them. He values them so highly. Isn't it sad you think about it? They don't value themselves so much. Man. You're blood-bought, property of the living God. Look back at that second portion of this combo parable. Look at verse 45. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking. Jesus says, I've come to seek and to save that which is lost. Beautiful pearls. This is interesting because the Jews had nothing to do with pearls. Is that interesting? They don't do pearls. Jesus has got everyone's attention now. They don't do pearls, which is really interesting because it's a Gentile thing, pearls. Even in Jesus' day, it was a Gentile thing. Isn't it sweet, though? In the book of Revelation, there's 12 gates, all made out of what? Solid. Each gate is one solid pearl. And the Jew would go, well, that's weird. We don't do ocean things. It's an unclean thing. Do you see the message Jesus is sending? Do you remember how we started this message? Jew, Gentile, all one, if you believe in Christ. People go, are you Jewish? Nope. But the God I worship is Jewish. It's fun. So think, watch. An oyster, this kind of fun. I did some oyster homework for this message. Where do you get pearls from? Have you ever seen an oyster?
Yes.
I should have brought one out here. They're one of the ugliest looking things on the planet. If you've never seen an oyster, if I showed you an oyster, you'd say there's no way that's an oyster. Well, listen, an oyster. It's interesting because it's a treasure, what's inside of it, that doesn't appear on the surface. You'd walk right past it. Look, people walk past us all the time. That's what's inside the oyster, huh? Where's the Holy Spirit? Inside you. Remember how we talked about a Sunday or two ago, whenever that was? The outward man is perishing, but the inward man's being renewed? Was that like last Sunday or last year? I can't remember. Wow, listen. Cleopatra. You know Cleopatra? She had that thing, her and Mark Anthony, all that stuff going on. She had a gift given to her. She wore on her neck two pearls that the size of them was recorded in Roman history, that today they're both estimated at nearly $500,000 each. Pearls, but that's Gentile. It's a weird story. You can read it later. She actually drank them. She dissolved them in vinegar to show her opulence and her love for Mark Anthony. Anyway, it has nothing to do with the Bible study. So, a pearl. Listen, a pearl is the only precious stone that comes out from a living organism. It's considered a stone, a precious stone. You know, like diamonds and all that stuff. But a pearl comes from a living organism. Diamonds are diamonds. Yes, they're made, compression, all that kind of stuff. Understand that? Secondly, a pearl can only be formed by an oyster that has been affected with an impurity. Did you know that a pearl starts out? A pearl is an impurity. The oyster's fine. He's cruising along, doing nothing, and something gets inside of it. A contaminant enters it. Can I just kind of make this a little bit more romantic? S-I-N, sin, positive. I watched my granddaughter before service tonight sin. She's 2.5. She committed a sin. Where did that come from? It's in her spiritual DNA to sin. Listen, an oyster starts, I got something in me. I don't like it. It's messing me up. I'm going to attack it. And it starts to attack it. It doesn't stop either, by the way. The oyster converts the impurity by wrapping it up, wrapping the irritant up with this secretion, over and over again in layers until it's no longer an irritant. What is foreign is dealt with. And this gets very fun. The word pearl is derived from the ancient Sanskrit meaning the pure. The irritant, could be sand, could be something, begins. Bothers the oyster begins to attack it. It winds up making one of the most beautiful, highly esteemed stones in all of the world. And its very meaning is that it becomes a pearl. The pearl of great price is the lost sinner. That through the work of the Spirit of God, the salvation of God, the blood of Christ, takes what was a sinful irritant, as it were, and brings out of it, makes out of it, something that even adorns heaven. What does Jesus think about you? Well, think about this. Can you imagine how valuable the church is to Jesus Christ? I mean, you can kind of figure that out right now more than ever. The church is getting beat up by everybody in every corner. All around the world. Well, that just kind of goes with the trend of things. Just know this. Jesus loves his church. A lot of people giving the church a black eye, persecuting the church, killing portions of the church. Just know this. Jesus loves his church. And he says so. And the Bible tells us that, and well, listen, Ephesians 5:26 says that he, Jesus, might sanctify and cleanse the church, her, with the washing of the water of the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Think about it. Sounds like a pearl in the making. That's how much God loves you. Our culture has been beaten down. I don't like our culture anymore. I think I lived it the best time. I loved my when I was growing up. It was just the best. But now everybody is, oh, you work, boo. Don't, you will never work. Don't try. If you try, you're going to get in trouble because you're going to stand out. Just be down here with the rest of us. It's really pathetic. It's amazing that Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and those dudes were born when they were born, because if they were born today, they wouldn't be able to think a thought. The church today has kind of adopted the culture. He's like, oh, don't say anything about love and life and eternity. Don't say the word Bible. Somebody might get upset. What in the world's going on? How are we ever going to rescue anybody? How are we ever going to invite people up to the mountaintop? So much of what is called the church is walking around saying, there's no mountaintop to go up to. Everything just, you know what I'm saying? It's a sad day. It's a sad day. If somebody stands up and says, Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, they're calling the cops, you know. Oh my goodness, there's a lunatic. There's a lunatic running down the mall. Jesus loves you. Somebody call the cops. We should do that some night. You know, like those flash mob things? We should go to the mall and just be walking along. Jesus loves you. Jesus. Can you imagine? Hey, if we all do it, then nobody will get arrested. They won't have enough. If we all do it, nobody will get arrested. So we should all do that. The third thing is this. The third thing is what Jesus thinks about you is how you're desired. He desires you. When the Bible here says in this parable that he had joy and he goes out and sells, verse 44, all that he has and buys the field, Jesus left heaven for us. The story is what is going to be saved and found He gives everything to come and come to us. How much does God desire you? Listen, how many of you want to go in heaven? You want to go to heaven? Raise your hand. You want to be in heaven? Put your hand down. You know what's hilarious about that? The very want that you have to go to heaven has been given to you by God. He wants you in heaven more than you want to be in heaven. Oh, I really hope I make it to heaven. He wants you there. What's the problem? Think about it. I want to go. Yes. But I don't know if he's going to. Well, he wants you to go. I don't know if I'm going to make it. Do you trust Christ? He rose again from the dead. Is he your Savior? Yes, he is. But I really want to go to heaven. Then go. He wants you there more than you want to go. It's amazing. His desire, Colossians 1:20. And by him to reconcile all things to himself, that's a lot. By him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Someone say amen. He wants you in heaven. His desire is to have you with him. Look, can I put it very, very reverently, but to the point? God is the one with the big idea. He's the one with the big idea. What's the big idea? He wrote the book and he announced to us, I want you in heaven with me. What's the problem, people? Come where I'm at. That's what the whole Bible's about. Think about the magnitude of that. He desires you. Luke 19:10 says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. Oh my goodness. You can't get better than that. Number four, what Jesus thinks about you is how you are welcomed. How you are welcomed. Isn't it beautiful that he speaks to us in the parable of as being a hidden treasure? A pearl? John 17 again, verse 23. Jesus in his high priestly prayer says, I in them, speaking to his Father, I in them, and you in me, that they may be made complete or perfect in one, and that the world may know that you've sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Excuse me, stop. Did you hear that? And have loved them, us, as you, the Father, have loved me, Jesus. Jesus is saying, you love me, Father, the same as you love them. This is the Bible. This is John 17:23. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus announced that God the Father loves you as much as he loves his Son. I don't get it. I don't get it. He said it. I believe that. It's going to take, no wonder why eternity is a long time. It's going to take us forever to think about that. You're welcome. Number five, we end with this. What Jesus thinks about you is how you're positioned. Oh man, we need this. How you are positioned. if someone's gonna put a treasure on display, you ever been to a good museum? A good one. You should go to the Getty. I've not been, but I've heard about it. I've been to some great museums in the world, but I have not been to that one, but I heard it's awesome. They have stuff on display. It's not just any stuff. It's amazing stuff. Not too long ago, I was at the British Museum. Unbelievable stuff. So, man, I'm reading this thing. And this is the scepter from Pharaoh what's-his-face, somebody, big time. This guy, and they got a Bible reference in this guy. He's like, what? And I'm thinking, well, that's got to be like a, you know, that's like a replica. And I'm looking at that, and I'm like, wow, that's amazing. There's no replicas. It's just, oh, my goodness, oh, my goodness. And I'm going like this. You see this? And you know what I crashed right into? I said, it's in a glass, but I ran right into it. Boom. The Rosetta Stone. You ever heard that? You ever heard of that? So what is that? It's a commercial. The Rosetta Stone, which is a miraculous thing. It's like, oh. Everything in there is real. On display. Saw the Hope Diamond. It was amazing. Hope Diamond, right here. Okay? Four guys with machine guns like this. You had to go through them. They wand you and all this stuff, pat you down before you go in there and look at it. And there's guys like this. There's just like this. On display. Lighting is perfect. Music, like spa music. On display. Okay? Listen, God has positioned you and I, the believer, in such a way that how we are right now, somehow in eternity, I don't know how we're going to be put on display, but we're going to be put on display in such a way that our salvation, redemption, and completion will bring so much glory and honor to the Lord. We're going to be like this, and it's not about us. It won't be. No angels are going to be walking by going, "Oh man." No one's going to do that. But we will be in eternity, having been saved by the Lamb of God, on display. And listen, the universe will say, "Isn't God amazing that He would save those people? He saved those oysters, those pearls. It's amazing." Now watch this, and we'll wrap this up with this big ending. Positioned. I'm so happy about what I'm going to be reading, because the truth is, God has a position for you. If you trust Jesus tonight, and let this bless you rather than create an argument in your head, stop fighting with God's word and enjoy it. Are you ready? Ephesians, I'm going to be reading from two areas, Ephesians and Romans. Blessed be, oh how happy, is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy. Isn't that amazing? You're not running toward it. In Christ, you have it. And without blame before Him in love. You are without blame before God in love right now. Tonight, the Bible says, "I don't know. You better." This is the Bible. God says you are positioned in front of Him in eternity, blameless right now. God lives in eternity. It's all the now there. He's not waiting for tomorrow. It's now. Isn't that amazing? Verse 5, having predestined us to adoption. I like that because God knows everything in advance. You can't teach Him anything. He knows everything. And it's not like we were born and so He's stuck with us. Oh, man. Oh, got to do something with this guy. Adopted. He picked us out as sons by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will. Romans 8:29. For whom He foreknew in advance. He knows in advance. He knows the whole thing in advance. Based on His foreknowledge, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. You are so beautifully positioned. Like in a crown or a tiara. Positions. He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He predestined, these He also called. Is He inviting you tonight? Did He invite you in the past? Whom He called, did He call you? Well, then He also justified you. And whom He justified, by the way, took away all claims against us. Canceled the case. These He also glorified. In the eternal mind of God, all of this is based on His foreknowledge, He sees us. Amazing. Right now, how positioned you are. Wow. Father, You are awesome. You are so good to us. And Lord, tonight we just praise You and thank You and worship You, Lord, for Your goodness. And Father, tonight, may we go from this place reveling in the fact that You see us in such a way that You left paradise and come down to this messed up ball at the end of the Milky Way galaxy, and you died here for us. May we never stop praising and thanking you for this. May we always be reminded of this great truth. May we look at others with the value, with the desire, with the love, with the welcome, with the position, that who knows, maybe the next person we bump into, these things describe your heart for them. Give us your heart. Give us your eyes, that we might see pearls in the making, treasures hidden, that we might tell every man, woman, boy, or girl about your wonderful love and what you think about us. And there's a man, the man Christ Jesus, who sees you in the world, and you're a treasure to him. Oh, that is precious. And verse 46 says, a pearl of great price. Valued. Jesus is communicating the great value of the lost sinner. It is awesome to think. He will not leave us lost in eternity forever. He came and provided a way. Now, granted, he will not make you go to heaven. You know that. I don't want anything to do with this. Then don't have anything to do with it. Just know this. God's truth and his announcement goes out to your heart just like it does to the person sitting next to you. It's what you do with it that will forever seal your fate in eternity. Will you accept his 100% provided free gift of salvation? No. Well, then listen. You are continuing down the path that you were born into. A path alienated from God and from his promises. But he loves even the worst of sinners who in this world are living, and those who have died. The Bible says that he weeps over the death of the wicked. You and I rejoice over the death of the wicked. God weeps over the death of the wicked. We all rejoice when Osama bin Laden got his dues. God wept. Isn't it weird to think? When Saddam Hussein died, God wept. I cheered. Isn't that pathetic? He's amazing. John 17, how valued are you? John 17, 1, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, this is a prayer. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. As you have given him authority, notice the Holy Spirit is speaking through Jesus, third person. As you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And here's the definition of eternal life. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. Wow. How much are you valued? So much that God would send his Son. Think of the depth of this meaning. Now go or look to 1 Corinthians 6:19. 1 Corinthians 6:19. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? And you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Remember the parable. A man saw a treasure in a field, and he bought it. A man saw a pearl of great price, and he bought it. Jesus bought. Isn't it strange? Jesus creates the universe, including the earth, but by his own life has to buy it or redeem it out of slavery, sin slavery. Why? He does that to get out of it precious things. God sees you as so valued. We're going to have to receive this by faith, people. It's just not normal for us to go, I'm so valued. Oh, am I loved? I understand that. But you know what? We are. It should change your attitudes a bit, huh? It should certainly affect how we treat other people. You're going to go home, you know, to that unbelieving wife or husband that let you go to church tonight. They're glad. Get out of here. Go take your Bible. Go sing your little songs. I'm going to watch the game, drink some beers, kick back. You can tell me all about the sermon when you get home tonight. Well, I know, you know, you're tempted to go home and, oh man, there's that bum. Jesus loves that bum. He loves them. He values them so highly. Isn't it sad you think about it? They don't value themselves so much. Man. You're blood-bought. Property of the living God. Look back at that second portion of this combo parable. Look at verse 45. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking. Jesus says, I've come to seek and to save that which is lost. Beautiful pearls. This is interesting because the Jews had nothing to do with pearls. Is that interesting? They don't do pearls. Jesus has got everyone's attention now. They don't do pearls, which is really interesting because it's a Gentile thing, pearls. Even in Jesus' day, it was a Gentile thing. Isn't it sweet, though? In the book of Revelation, there's 12 gates, all made out of what? Solid. Each gate is one solid pearl. And the Jew would go, well, that's weird. We don't do ocean things. It's an unclean thing. Do you see the message Jesus is sending? Do you remember how we started this message? Jew, Gentile, all one, if you believe in Christ. People go, are you Jewish? Nope. But the God I worship is Jewish. That's fun. So, think, watch. An oyster, this is kind of fun. I did some oyster homework for this message. Where do you get pearls from? Have you ever seen an oyster?
Yes.
I should have brought one out here. They're one of the ugliest looking things on the planet. If you've never seen an oyster, if I showed you an oyster, you'd say, there's no way that's an oyster. Well, listen, an oyster. It's interesting because it's a treasure, what's inside of it, that doesn't appear on the surface. You'd walk right past it. Look, people walk past us all the time. That's what's inside the oyster, huh? Where's the Holy Spirit? Inside you. Remember how we talked about a Sunday or two ago, whenever that was? The outward man is perishing, but the inward man's being renewed? Was that like last Sunday or last year? I can't remember. Wow, listen. Cleopatra. You know Cleopatra? She had that thing, her and Mark Anthony, all that stuff going on. She had a gift given to her. She wore on her neck two pearls that the size of them was recorded in Roman history, that today they're both estimated at nearly $500,000 each. Pearls. But that's Gentile. It's a weird story. You can read it later. She actually drank them. She dissolved them in vinegar to show her opulence and her love for Mark Anthony. Anyway, it has nothing to do with the Bible study. So, a pearl. Listen, a pearl is the only precious stone that comes out from a living organism. It's considered a stone, a precious stone. You know, like diamonds and all that stuff. But a pearl comes from a living organism. Diamonds are diamonds. Yes, they're made, compression, all that kind of stuff. Understand that? Secondly, a pearl can only be formed by an oyster that has been affected with an impurity. Did you know that a pearl starts out? A pearl is an impurity. The oyster's fine. He's cruising along, doing nothing, and something gets inside of it. A contaminant enters it. Can I just kind of make this a little bit more romantic? Some important information here. Jesus said to both Jew and Gentile alike, Matthew 10, verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles. Isn't that a shocker? The first missionary journey, Jesus tells his disciples, don't preach the good news to the Gentiles. And do not enter a city of the Samaritans. But go rather to what? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Some of your Bibles say the kingdom of heaven is near you. That's a good word. The kingdom of God is the opportunity for you to have the lordship of Jesus Christ ruling and reigning over your life. Now, you guys all know that's true. You are not going to go to heaven because the lordship of Jesus Christ is ruling and reigning over your church or whatever, wherever your membership might be or wherever you attend a church service. The church cannot save you, and you're not going to go to heaven riding on the back of your church. That's impossible. The kingdom of God comes near every one of us. The preaching of the gospel is to announce that the kingdom of God is near you. And what's the whole thrust and the whole finish to that? The kingdom of God is near you, so open up your heart and receive him and be saved. That's what we're all about. That's what you want to be about. But the offer of salvation based upon the very words of Jesus Christ himself, which, listen, he's fulfilling the very prophecies of the Old Testament, had to first begin with the nation of Israel. Do you understand that? It had to go to Israel first. And you've read the book of Acts where when they kept refusing the gospel, then they said, okay, listen, then we're going to go to the Gentiles. The Lord's opened the door for us to go to the Gentiles. This does not mean we stop witnessing to Jews. In fact, I've got to tell you, I would much rather witness to a Jewish person than a Gentile person. Because Gentile people witnessing is very boring. And when you witness to a Jewish person, it is so much fun. It's a blast. You still tell the Jewish people about the gospel. There are Jews still getting saved. But there's a veil, as 2 Corinthians 4 talks about, over their eyes at a time like this. God lifts it from time to time and open hearts within the Jewish nation, people. But the gospel is going to the ends of the earth right now. And that's God's plan. God has not cast away the Jews forever. Book of Romans makes it very clear. God's people will be restored. There'll be a remnant saved, and it's awesome. The future of Israel, though there's tremendous tribulation coming, the future is prophetic, biblical, and amazing. Exodus 19, 3 through 5. Mark it down in your margins. Mark it down in your notes. Exodus 19, 3. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, thus you shall say to the house of Jacob. What's another name for Jacob? Israel. And tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you out to myself. Therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Keep that in mind. Now watch this. God is still fulfilling his word with Israel and the Jew. Watch now. Turn to Galatians 3:26. Galatians 3:26. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. Now, who's he talking to? He's talking to the church at Galatia, but who's going to read this? These are Gentiles. But listen, the church, when the church first got started, it was almost exclusively Jews who had gotten saved. Did you know that? There were very few Gentiles that had gotten saved. Now the gospel is advancing. It's going out. Verse 27, Galatians 3. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither, what? Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. Isn't that amazing? That is awesome. Ephesians 2:11. Ephesians 2:11. Are you guys turning the pages in your Bible or turning the pages on your iPad or whatever you're doing there? Okay. I see you glowing out there. I see your screens. Ephesians 2:11. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, Gentile Jew, made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, he's talking about the Gentiles, having no hope, without God in the world. But now Christ Jesus, you who once were far off, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Do you remember when Jesus told Nicodemus, the chief master Jewish teacher, you need to be born again? How does a Jew get to heaven? The same way you get to heaven. Jesus told a Jew in John 3, you must be born again. Jesus told that to a Jew before he ever told it to Gentiles. How does a Jew, how does a Gentile get to heaven? You've got to be born again, okay? God came to save sinners. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
This is what the Bible teaches. So, what Jesus thinks about you, mark it down number one, is, oh, how you are loved. Loved. Don't let anyone misinterpret this parable and rob you of great joy, my friend, ever. Look at your Bible, mark verse 44. You are loved. That's what this parable is communicating. In fact, look, Matthew 13, 44, there in it says, for joy over it, that is the treasure hidden in the field. Look at verse 46, who when he had found one pearl of great price. Don't think for a moment that the hidden treasure is Jesus and the pearl of great price is Jesus. That is not what this parable teaches. There are hymns that are written saying such a thing, and it is biblically inaccurate. Number one thing, mark it down, and you'll see it come to light in a moment. What Jesus thinks about you, Jew or Gentile, right now, is that you are loved. You are loved by God in such a way that it is unfathomable for you to comprehend. It is beyond your scope of understanding how much God loves you. And don't equate for a moment what you're going through in life is basing or somehow indicating God's love for you or God's God not loving you. That has nothing to do with what he has said. He says, I love you. Who has he said this to? Well, how far do you want to carry this? Number one, he says it to the Jewish nation, to the Jewish people. He loves them. He says to the Gentile world, I love you. And if that's not satisfactory enough, the Bible tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. More on that in a moment. God announces in the Bible of his great love for you. What does Jesus think about you? He's the one giving the parable. And this gets very, very exciting. Because he's talking about the kingdom of heaven. And it is like a treasure hidden in a field. We know from our previous studies in what is called expositional constancy, a law of biblical interpretation, you can't mess it up. If you do mess it up, then you create a cult. That's how you create a cult, is that you do not obey the laws of biblical interpretation. Number one, we've already been introduced to what the field is. The field is the world. Jesus already told us that. In the world, there is a treasure that is hidden in the world. Keep this mind going. Keep this thought going. Which a man found and hid. Now, a man found and hid. Who would be the man? The interpretation, consistently, a man went out and sowed seed. Do you remember who that was? None other than the Lord himself. Remember? The seed was the word of God. The man, Jesus, is speaking of himself. Well, then why does it say that he hid? He got it, he found, and he hid. Watch this. The word doesn't mean hide, like Jesus found you and he wants to keep you under wraps and not let you come out. It speaks about the sovereignty of God in what he knows. Listen, tonight, let's grab our Bibles and turn, if you would, to a couple of places, to be honest with you. It's going to be a lot of Bible tonight, and I hope you would say you get a lot of Bible every Wednesday night, but this is going to be kind of neat because I'll spare you a lot of hassle in the sense that the portion of Matthew 13, go ahead and turn there, Matthew 13, it is a combo deal tonight. We get a combo deal, a supersized version of the same truth. In fact, Jesus brings this parable before the hearers wrapped up together. Yes, technically, Bible students, if you're taking a test, these are two separate parables, but they're the only two separate parables that land the airplane at the same field. They come back to the same purpose. They may have a little bit of variation, but the players are the same, the point is the same, and the landing is the same. That's why tonight you see that we've entitled it this way, the parable of the hidden treasures, plural, okay? There is the pearl of great price. You heard about that parable? That's going to be incorporated into this. And then you've heard of the parable of the hidden treasure. They both speak of the same thing, which causes us to take notice. Before we get going into this, I'm going to ask you to have your pens ready and have your Bibles very, very handy so you can get into this. Before we get to Matthew 13, 44 to 46, I'm going to remind you of Matthew 13, 1. On the same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the sea of Galilee. And great multitudes gathered together to him so that he got into a boat and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore. Verse 3, then he spoke many things to them in parables. Are you ready to use your Bible? Holding your finger in Matthew 13, run to the left. It's about in the middle of your Bible. If you shut your Bible and open it up, you're going to land in either the book of Psalms or Isaiah. Go to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6. And while you're turning there, I want to remind you, Jesus spoke to the people in parables. The crowds in parables. Isaiah 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, Isaiah says, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train, or his glory, of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim. They are incredibly bizarre types of angelic creatures. Why? Each one of the seraphim have six wings. With two, he covered his face. In the presence of God, their face is always covered. And with two, he covered his feet. And with the remaining two, he flew. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Wow. And the post, Isaiah says, of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out. And the house was filled with smoke. So I said, woe is me, For I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar, and he touched my mouth with it. And he said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away, and your sin purged. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, send me. And he said, go and tell this people, keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and return and be healed. What is God saying? Wow. I have preached to these people. I have sent my prophets. I have cried out to them. I have done miracles. I know them. They know who I am, but they don't obey me. And God says, that's it. The book of Isaiah continues to speak on, and God says, I will speak to the people in parables. The truth will land right alongside their ear, but because they're not willing, watch church, because they're not willing to obey the truth that lands right alongside them, instead of blessing them, their heart won't receive it. And their heart will turn that very word that can liberate someone, it will turn it into a curse for them. Because they're not open. That is a grave warning to any of us who take lightly the word of God. Parables are serious business. A parable, as we've mentioned before, is a multifunction way of delivering truth. And when it approaches a willing heart and mind, it unlocks that willing heart and mind more. It brings more light. Are you willing tonight to know the word of God and to be open to God? Are you willing tonight to say, God, here I am, send me. Woe unto me, I'm the one that's undone. Woe unto me, God, I'm in trouble. And have you had, as it were, the seraphim fly from the altar and, as it were, announce unto you, your iniquity has been taken away and your sin purged? And your response will be, without rights, without defense, here I am. That person, that heart of yours, God says, get out of my way. See that heart? I want to pour more light into that heart. Oh, when I throw out my word, their heart is so hungry for it. And listen, as they sit in darkness, when the word of God lands, they grab it and light begins to shine out of darkness. And they begin to see. A parable acts as a judge. And we need to remember that. So the message for tonight is this: what Jesus thinks about you. What Jesus thinks about you. We're going to finish that statement here in 5 points. And I need all of you to listen carefully, because you can get 100 pastors and 50 of them will interpret this parable one way and 50 will interpret it the other way. And I want you to know tonight, we're going to interpret it the right way. You'll see why in a moment. It's a lot of fun. What Jesus thinks about you. Here we go. It's Matthew 13, verses 44 to 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Verse 45. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. The kingdom of heaven. Jesus is announcing what it's like. Let's be very careful tonight, and note takers, this now is very much my opinion. It's necessary to share it. You might say, well, who cares about your opinion? I understand that, but it works for the study tonight, and I need you to hear this. It's foundational, I believe. When we talk about the kingdom of heaven, let's be very careful to remember this, that the kingdom of heaven, first of all, means this. It is the rule and the reign of the Messiahship of Jesus Christ in a person's life is the number one thing. Remember that. That's where it begins. The kingdom of heaven is the rule and the reign of Christ, of Messiah, in an individual's life. But for the nation of Israel, there is both a personal salvation in the Messiah and a national salvation for the nation of Israel. Follow along now, and I need you to be ready. We're going to give you... Jesus cannot learn anything. God cannot learn anything. And this verse speaks of that in the earth, think about it, for the last 2,000 years, God, who alone knows this, every generation of people, there are believers that to the mind of God, he already knows who they are. How does that, doesn't that get you excited? I like that. What are we supposed to do? Preach to every creature. Because we don't know. Evangelize everybody. But God knows who's going to accept him. How does that play out in the parable? Oh, Jesus says they're hidden in this world. Think about the people that you're going to see in your ministry lifetime, in your faithfulness to Christ, that are going to accept the Lord. Is it going to be your grandma? Is it going to be your child? Is it going to be your neighbor? Isn't it amazing? Right now, they are as though they were hidden, but not to the mind of God. You don't know. I don't know. That's why we're supposed to preach to everybody. Are you with me? Well, you know, I'm going to wait and see. Oh, let it go. Jesus said, go preach to every creature. You can walk around Chino Hills and preach to the cattle roaming out there and practice on them. Or to be more biblical, I guess you could go down the road and preach to some sheep. Keep it in the family, you know? But God loves us. The communication is love. And I want you to think about this for a moment. Why did Jesus Christ leave heaven to come here? Why would Jesus put up with mankind's dealings with him as mankind has dealt with him? Why? Why would Jesus subject himself to the cross? The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews that Jesus embraced the cross for the joy that was set before him. You ever think about that? Jesus never tried to get off the cross. He never tried to get out of it. You and I would have tried to get out of it. We would have done everything to get out of the cross. Jesus didn't. Jesus, in fact, said, when the time comes, I'm going to lay down my life. The Bible says that he never opened his mouth in defense. Read the fine print. He said, I lay down my life and I will raise it up again. Wow. John 3:16, I mentioned a moment ago, check this out. For God so loved the world, that's the field in the parable, that he gave his only begotten son. This is the price paid, the gift given, salvation, that whoever would be the pearls or whoever would be the treasure. Mark it down, it's going to come together later. Some of you are going, what? Believes on him should not perish but have everlasting life. That is salvation. And let me add this. Isn't it precious that the Bible tells us that when one sinner repents and comes to Christ in salvation, that the angels in heaven rejoice over one convert to Christ. That is absolutely awesome. It's all about the love of God for you. Jesus Christ, the cross, his mission, his brutality received, The ministry revealed is all because he loves humans. And you might say, well, okay, I'll give you that. He loves humans. He loves you. Why do we resist this? I'm prone to this too. I'm confessing for you. It seems more economic to me if Jesus would love more people. Maybe this section over here. There's more. But that's how you and I think. We think like this, how much can I get for that? How many of those do I get for this much, right? Yeah. We're just looking for a deal, which is great, but in the mind of God, he doesn't have that economy like we do. I can't explain this. How is it that God is 100% delighted over the fact that he would have come and died on the cross for one sinner? If Adam and Eve would have been the only ones that have ever lived after their fall, Jesus still would have come and died. I don't get that. Come on, Costco, load up my pallet, man. If I'm going to lay down 10 bucks, I want 500 of them. God doesn't think like that. Isn't it amazing? That should comfort you because he loves you so much that he goes through every situation with you and he's going to take you through every situation. He's absolutely committed because he's not a human. He came and became a human for us. He is God Almighty. He's eternal. He is spirit. Jesus said that God is spirit and he is truth. And though that sounds too good for us, it is true. He loves you, and he would have died for you. This gets fun. You ready? Jeremiah 31:3, which will explain why we had that elongated introduction. Jeremiah 31:3. Yes, God said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you. Bible students paying attention, who is he speaking to? Anybody? Class, anyone? Class. He was speaking to Israel. He was speaking to the nation of Israel. But Pastor, I love that verse. I do too. Well, is it for Israel? Yes. Oh, I thought it was for me. Yes. Well, who's it for? You. But what if I'm not Jewish? It's yours. What if I am Jewish? It's yours. Here's the requirement, Nicodemus. Do you believe him? There's neither Jew nor Gentile. All the promises of God in Christ Jesus are yes and amen. Every one of them. That is good news. So as a Gentile, can I say that God has loved me with an everlasting love? Oh, yeah. And he's drawn me to himself? Oh, yeah. Is there a New Testament counterpart to that? Oh, yeah. John 6:37. Jesus said, all that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. Those verses are eternally connected. The promise first given to Israel, but now has been adopted by the Christian. Because mark this verse down. It just came into my mind. It's not going to be on the screen. It's Romans chapter 2, verses 28 to 29 says, he is not a Jew who is one circumcised outwardly of the flesh with human hands, but he is a Jew who is circumcised inwardly, whose circumcision is of the heart and not of hands, whose praise is not from men, but from God. What does that mean? That the word Jew, is your name Jude? Is your name Jude? Anybody? How about Judy? Any Judys here tonight? No Judys? One Judy on the aisle. Well, for her, the word Jew, Jude, Judy, Judith, is one who praises, a praiser, to praise God. So all the rest of you don't know what I'm talking about, apparently. Isn't that amazing? Who's a real Jew? A real Jew is one who's been circumcised in the heart. That's the issue. How does Jew and Gentile become one? Only one way. Is your heart circumcised? I like that. Number two tonight is this. What Jesus thinks about you is how you are valued. The value of you. Now, you guys need to really eat this message up because this is the most positive message I think I've ever delivered in my life. I mean, he loves you. He just oozes over you. And he values you greatly. He values you beyond your ability to estimate yourself or anyone else. Just think about the people that we might say under our breath or maybe out loud, I don't like them. Well, you know what? Now you're at odds with God. Oh, yeah, but they're so obnoxious. He loves them. You ever seen somebody that you just absolutely, I wouldn't give that guy the time of day. Jesus gave that guy his life. Wow. You're so valued. Back to the parable, verses 44 and 46 again, treasure hidden in the field, treasure. The parable says you are a treasure hidden in the field of the world. S-I-N, sin, positive. I watched my granddaughter before service tonight sin. She's 2.5. She committed a sin. Where did that come from? It's in her spiritual DNA to sin. Listen, an oyster starts, I got something in me. I don't like it. It's messing me up. I'm going to attack it. And it starts to attack it. It doesn't stop either, by the way. The oyster converts the impurity by wrapping it up, wrapping the irritant up with this secretion over and over again in layers until it's no longer an irritant. What is foreign is dealt with. And this gets very fun. The word pearl is derived from the ancient Sanskrit meaning the pure. The irritant, could be sand, could be something, begins, bothers the oyster begins to attack it. It winds up making one of the most beautiful, highly esteemed stones in all of the world. And its very meaning is that it becomes a pearl. The pearl of great price is the lost sinner. That through the work of the Spirit of God, the salvation of God, the blood of Christ, takes what was a sinful irritant, as it were, and brings out of it, makes out of it, something that even adorns heaven. What does Jesus think about you? Well, think about this. Can you imagine how valuable the church is to Jesus Christ? I mean, you can kind of figure that out right now more than ever. The church is getting beat up by everybody in every corner. All around the world. Well, that just kind of goes with the trend of things. Just know this. Jesus loves his church. A lot of people giving the church a black eye, persecuting the church, killing portions of the church. Just know this. Jesus loves his church. And he says so. And the Bible tells us that, and well, listen, Ephesians 5:26 says that he, Jesus, might sanctify and cleanse the church, her, with the washing of the water of the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Think about it. Sounds like a pearl in the making. That's how much God loves you. Our culture has been beaten down. I don't like our culture anymore. I think I lived it the best time. I loved my when I was growing up. It was just the best. But now everybody is, oh, you work, boo. Don't, you will never work. Don't try. If you try, you're going to get in trouble because you're going to stand out. Just be down here with the rest of us. It's really pathetic. It's amazing that Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and those dudes were born when they were born, because if they were born today, they wouldn't even get out of, they wouldn't be able to think a thought. The church today has kind of adopted the culture. He's like, oh, don't say anything about love and life and eternity. Don't say the word Bible. Somebody might get upset. What in the world's going on? How are we ever going to rescue anybody? How are we ever going to invite people up to the mountaintop? So much of what is called the church is walking around saying, there's no mountain top to go up to. Everything just, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's a sad day. It's a sad day. If somebody stands up and says, Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, they're calling the cops, you know. Oh my goodness, there's a lunatic. There's a lunatic running down the mall. Jesus loves you. Somebody call the cops. We should do that some night. You know, like those flash mob things? We should go to the mall and just be walking along. Jesus loves you, Jesus. Can you imagine? Hey, if we all do it, then nobody will get arrested. They won't have enough. If we all do it, nobody will get arrested. So we should all do that. The third thing is this. The third thing is what Jesus thinks about you is how you're desired. He desires you. When the Bible here says in this parable that he had joy and he goes out and sells, verse 44, all that he has and buys the field, Jesus left heaven for us. The story is what is going to be saved and found, he gives everything to come to us. How much does God desire you? Listen, how many of you want to go in heaven? You want to go to heaven? Raise your hand. You want to be in heaven? Put your hand down. You know what's hilarious about that? The very want that you have to go to heaven has been given to you by God. He wants you in heaven more than you want to be in heaven. Oh, I really hope I make it to heaven. He wants you there. What's the problem? Think about it. I want to go. Yes. But I don't know if he's going to. Well, he wants you to go. I don't know if I'm going to make it. Do you trust Christ? He rose again from the dead. Is he your Savior? Yes, he is. But I really want to go to heaven. Then go. He wants you there more than you want to go. It's amazing. His desire, Colossians 1:20. And by him to reconcile all things to himself, that's a lot. By him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Someone say amen. He wants you in heaven. His desire is to have you with him. Look, can I put it very, very reverently, but to the point? God is the one with the big idea. He's the one with the big idea. What's the big idea? He wrote the book and he announced to us, I want you in heaven with me. What's the problem, people? Come where I'm at. That's what the whole Bible's about. Think about the magnitude of that. He desires you. Luke 19:10 says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. Oh my goodness. You can't get better than that. Amen. Number four, what Jesus thinks about you is how you are welcomed. How you are welcomed. Isn't it beautiful that he speaks to us in the parable of as being a hidden treasure? A pearl? John 17 again, verse 23. Jesus in his high priestly prayer says, I in them, speaking to his Father, I in them and you in me, that they may be made complete or perfect in one. And that the world may know that you've sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Excuse me, stop. Did you hear that? And have loved them, us, as you, the Father, have loved me, Jesus. Jesus is saying, you love me, Father, the same as you love them. This is the Bible. This is John 17:23. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus announced that God the Father loves you as much as he loves his Son. I don't get it. I don't get it. He said it. I believe that. It's going to take, no wonder why eternity is a long time. It's going to take us forever to think about that. You're welcome. Number five, we end with this. What Jesus thinks about you is how you're positioned. Oh man, we need this. How you are positioned. if someone's gonna put a treasure on display, You ever been to a good museum? A good one. You should go to the Getty. I've not been, but I've heard about it. I've been to some great museums in the world, but I have not been to that one, but I heard it's awesome. They have stuff on display. It's not just any stuff. It's amazing stuff. Not too long ago, I was at the British Museum. Unbelievable stuff.